Hi everyone, welcome to Hub Bites. I'm Sanil Rege, consultant psychiatrist. Today I'll be taking you through an important topic, a topic that many of our viewers have written about when we've talked about antidepressants, and we're going to cover antidepressant-induced sexual dysfunction. I'm going to talk about what are the phases of the sexual response cycle, how antidepressants affect that particular those phases, how to prevent antidepressant-induced sexual dysfunction and treatment. So we have created chapters, so have a look in the description section if you want to just go to one particular section and just click on those chapters as well. So without further ado, let's get started. So sexual dysfunction is defined as a persistent change occurring in any of the stages of the sexual response cycle, which of course causes a lot of distress to the patient. There are four stages of the sexual response cycle: pleasure, desire, arousal, and orgasm. And the arousal is where the erection aspect comes in as well. So when we think about sexual dysfunction, we know that it is a known side effect associated with certain antidepressants. But at the same time, it is also associated with depression, the illness itself. We know low libido, erectile dysfunction can be a very core feature of depression. Depression is associated with a 50 to 70% increased risk of sexual dysfunction, while sexual dysfunction itself increases the risk of depression by 130 to 200%. So really, really high odds of sexual dysfunction resulting in depression. In the general population, the prevalence of sexual dysfunction is approximately 43% in women, 31% in males. The prevalence increases to approximately 60 to 80% in anxiety, mood, psychotic disorders. So psychiatric illnesses can be closely associated with sexual dysfunction independent of medication in a way. Now, how do antidepressants cause sexual dysfunction? The main antidepressants that are associated with sexual dysfunction are SSRIs, the selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, and the SNRIs, the serotonin noradrenaline reuptake inhibitors. And you might notice the common aspect between these two is the S, the serotonin component. So serotonin, we know that SSRIs and SNRIs increase serotonin levels because they actually inhibit the serotonin transporter, which is the protein that that's responsible for the uptake of serotonin in the presynaptic neuron. So we've covered SNRI psychopharmacology and SSRI psychopharmacology as videos, so do have a listen to those. Now, serotonin directly reduces the sensation in the reproductive system, anatomical structures. So diminishes erection, vaginal lubrication, ejaculation, and orgasm. So really all phases. It also inhibits nitric oxide production, which is really important in the relaxation of the smooth muscle of vessels, including the vasculature of the reproductive structures. So it's responsible for that vasodilatation, allowing sufficient blood supply to the sexual organs during the sexual response cycle. And that vasodilatation is, of course, very, very important when it comes to the whole process of the sexual response cycle. Then we have a specific receptor, the 5-HT1A receptor, which we know that when that receptor is activated, it increases levels of dopamine and noradrenaline. And these receptors are, in a way, you can think about them as a pleasure neurotransmitters. They're important aspects for erection, libido, drive, sexual desire. Therefore, what happens is some antidepressants do not have this 5-HT1A agonist activity. And those ones have a higher incidence of sexual dysfunction than those that have the 5-HT1A, amongst the SSRIs mainly. So therefore, we find that, you see, fluvoxamine, so if an SSRI is considered, fluvoxamine has a lower incidence. Why? Because it actually has this 5-HT1A agonistic activity. But we'll talk about it because doses are relevant when it comes to fluvoxamine. So what are the sexual side effects in women and men when we think about these agents? Women, the most commonly reported adverse sexual side effects are problems with sexual desire and sexual arousal. SSRIs, 42% of women report problems having an orgasm. SNRIs, it's associated with delayed or absent orgasm. So Orgasm seems to feature quite prominently in women. When it comes to men, with SSRIs, there is delayed ejaculation. And interestingly, this is SSRIs are used as a treatment for premature ejaculation, but also associated with erectile dysfunction. The erectile dysfunction risk is higher with paroxetine, citalopram, and venlafaxine. Now, venlafaxine at lower levels acts as an SSRI. At higher levels, becomes an SNRI. And SNRIs in males, again, you get erectile dysfunction and abnormal ejaculation. Now, how is it assessed? I find the PAM-D approach really, really helpful. And this is something that Professor Anita Clayton has talked about. We've covered this as well during the where I interviewed Professor Anita Clayton. And she talks about, firstly, plan in advance to talk about sexual dysfunction. So even patients, it's important to actively, proactively bring it up. But for doctors and health professionals, it's important to ask about that. Second is ask. If you ask the question, it gives patients the opportunity to talk about it. 70% of people wanted to talk about it, but if we don't ask, it's not discussed. Monitor. Monitor sexual side effects at each visit after the medication has been initiated. And then discuss the D component. Discuss the pros and cons of different medications, because there are medications that are you can be used for treatment or don't have sexual dysfunction as a side effect. So PAM-D, plan, ask, monitor, and discuss. When we think about assessment, it is very, very important in the clinical history to rule out medical conditions. Because we know a number of diabetes, for example, excessive substance use, alcohol use, nerve dysfunction, these aspects can affect sexual function, Parkinson's disease, etc. History of past sexual dysfunction, past surgical procedures, current medications. We know besides antidepressants, other medications like diuretics, ACE inhibitors, anticholinergic medications, these medications can be associated with sexual dysfunction. Substance use history, drugs, alcohol, etc. Psychiatric history, because we saw that there is a high correlation between psychiatric disorders and low libido or low desire, erectile dysfunction, etc. And then we have menopause. There is also something known as hypoactive sexual desire disorder. Somewhat, you know, there's debate whether it's sort of present or not, but we do have treatments for it, such as flibanserin, which, you know, ADDI it's called, the new medication. But it's something to take into account in women. And of course, the hormonal aspects during menopause, where we have the hormonal treatments that can be considered. So an overall holistic view is important before jumping to the conclusion that it's purely due to antidepressants. Rating scales can be used. Now, some of these are the Arizona Sexual Experience Scale, changes in sexual functioning questionnaire, sex effects scale, the PRSexDQ. So these are some of the scales that can be used, but clinical evaluation with the patient as a start is really important. So let's look at two aspects. Firstly, prevention of sexual dysfunction. Whenever, as a clinician, I'm considering starting an antidepressant, a risk-benefit analysis is important, discussion of side effects and sexual dysfunction should be talked about. So agents that are friendly with regards to this particular property are agomelatine, bupropion, and mirtazapine. Agomelatine is essentially an agent that antagonizes the 5-HT2C receptor. The 5-HT2C receptor is situated lower down in the spinal cord, and if you activate that receptor, it can lead to sexual dysfunction, and that's what SSRIs, SNRIs do. Agomelatine actually antagonizes that receptor, so it actually can treat sexual dysfunction and has a lower incidence of sexual dysfunction. So in many cases, if someone has SSRI-induced sexual dysfunction, there are a few strategies. One can add on agomelatine whilst reducing the dose so that of SSRI so that the person doesn't relapse. So these are some of the strategies, and I'll talk about the specific strategies in the next sort of slide. But agomelatine is a useful agent. It also has melatonin-promoting properties. It's a good antidepressant overall. Metabolically friendly, so weight gain is not an issue. Emotional blunting isn't an issue. Sexual dysfunction isn't an issue. So it's a good antidepressant to consider. Second, bupropion. Bupropion is one of the few agents, as you can see here, has the most scientific evidence for low treatment emergent sexual dysfunction and can also improve sexual function. It is an NDRI, which means it increases noradrenaline, dopamine. does not affect serotonin receptors at all. And then we have mirtazapine. Mirtazapine also antagonizes the 5-HT2C receptor and therefore can treat sexual dysfunction, has a lower incidence, but it does have a drawback of increasing of weight gain, of increasing weight because of its antihistaminergic property. So therefore, you know, this is something to discuss overall when starting agents. Now, these are the antidepressants that have no significant effect. This is based on the reviews. Agomelatine, desvenlafaxine as well, but it is an SNRI, but in some cases, it's considered to have a lower effect. Having said that, sexual dysfunction can occur. Moclobamide, which is a REMA, which is a reversible monoamine oxidase inhibitor, A. And then we have trazodone. So trazodone, again, 5-HT2 antagonist, useful agent. Vilazodone is another agent not available in Australia, available in the US. We have vortioxetine, which is, again, a multimodal antidepressant, can be useful as well. So these newer antidepressants, agomelatine, vortioxetine, are worth consideration. Then we have the evidence for duloxetine, levomilnacipran, and mirtazapine is inconclusive. This is from another paper. And if SSRIs are to be considered, consider fluvoxamine, because of that 5-HT1A, and it says it's considered to have the least incidence of sexual dysfunction under doses of 100 milligrams per day. But in some cases, higher doses are required, in which case you can still have this effect. Now, when we're thinking about treating it, now someone presents to me with sexual dysfunction, we have the following options. First, wait and watch, because in the initial stages, the receptors may sensitize and this side effect may go down. That's a possibility. Some cases that doesn't happen, it persists. Then dose reduction may be an option. Reduce the dose whilst ensuring they don't relapse into the primary illness of depression or anxiety that the medication has been prescribed for. Then we can consider, now drug holidays has been mentioned there, as you can see. Not an ideal strategy because it poses withdrawal symptoms for patients. So that's sort of lower down the list. But augmentation and switching strategies can be considered. Now, switching strategies means that we are completely stopping one and starting one, another one. So that can pose with SSRIs and SNRI withdrawal symptoms. Now, we've covered antidepressant withdrawal symptoms and tapering in another video. Do have a listen to that one. So therefore, augmentation may be considered first. So let's say someone's on an SSRI or an SNRI, and we're thinking dose reduction hasn't worked, but any further dose reduction may actually lead to a relapse. So in that case, what one might do is to reduce the dose. If they start having symptoms of depression coming back, then a sexually friendly antidepressant can be considered, like agomelatine, to add on, which does not have a risk of serotonin syndrome because it does not increase serotonin. Or add on mirtazapine, or add on bupropion. Now, this is specialist treatment. It's not to be construed as medical advice, really important. Should be discussed with the doctor, but these are strategies that can be used. These agents can be combined whilst the other one goes down. And then one can then decide later on, okay, I might take them off it or they might stay on it. And that's a discussion you have with the doctor, but this is a strategy that can work quite well. And finally, augmentation can lead to a switch, because one might say, my depression's treated, I don't have sexual dysfunction, can we stop the other medication? And that might be considered once gradual tapering withdrawal symptoms are taken into account. So I hope that this gives you an idea. What we want to do is firstly, make sure that we are proactive in asking about it. Two, discussing it with patients, the side effects of sexual dysfunction with antidepressants. Third, always a thorough medical history during evaluation if they have sexual dysfunction. We try to prevent it as much as possible by choosing agents that are friendly, agomelatine, mirtazapine, bupropion, vortioxetine. These are ones really at the top of my mind because they have a lower incidence of not only sexual dysfunction, but other side effects as well. Mirtazapine being an exception for weight gain. So you've got these possibilities, but if a patient's already on it, wait and watch, dose reduction, switching, or augmentation. Of course, drug holidays, a little bit controversial because it can cause harm in the form of withdrawal symptoms. So I hope that this gives you an overview of antidepressant-induced sexual dysfunction. It's a very, very distressing side effect. Now, I haven't covered persistent sexual dysfunction with SSRIs, persistent SSRI-induced sexual dysfunction, PSSD. It is an established entity. It is a difficult entity to treat. Bupropion has been talked about there. The true incidence is actually not known. So again, I've written more about this on psychscenehub.com, where I've written a detailed article on antidepressant-induced sexual dysfunction present. A couple of other things that I haven't mentioned are also in erectile dysfunction. Now, often one thinks about Viagra, so sildenafil, tadalafil, Cialis, which is longer acting, so one doesn't have to take it just half an hour before the act. One can actually take it and it lasts for 3 days or so, so one doesn't have to have that pressure of timing. Now, these can be used, but they're much better when used for the erectile dysfunction. So again, these are aspects to discuss with the doctor. And I mentioned flibanserin, ADI, in hypoactive sexual desire disorder, particularly in women, is something to that is being talked about. Not much is known whether it actually helps for SSRI-induced sexual dysfunction or SNRI, but we might know more about this later on. So thank you very much for watching and supporting our channel. I really, really appreciate your input and really your time as well. So I hope to see you in another edition of Hub Bites. Until then, take care and stay safe. Bye-bye.